Sue was a, I'm the chair of the Department of Economics, it's actually my first year in this kind of event, and I'm extremely happy to be here, see all the happy faces of our students, families, even faculty. I'm gonna be introducing our next speaker. Our next speaker is Vincent Cassidy. Thanks for coming. Vincent Cassidy was born and raised in Rhode Island, actually. And he did a bachelor's degree in economics in Stony Brook University. And he graduated in 1981. So I guess that calls for a double welcome back home. Thanks for coming. And thanks for being with us today. I'm going to give you a brief overview of, sorry, in different role. It's my fault, I'm too short. So let me give you a brief overview of Vincent's achievements, and then I'll lend him the floor, because you are a lot more interested in what he has to say than what we have to say. So Vincent finished his bachelor's degree in economics here, and after that he went to graduate school at the University of Virginia, and from there he moved to an increasingly stellar career in banking and real estate. In fact, after a few years, you say something like 25 or so? Something like that? Yeah. After 25 years in the banking industry, he decided to step up a little bit more and created his own company. He founded in 2006 Majesty Title Services, which, for those of you who don't know, is one of the largest title companies servicing the East Coast of the United States. And in fact, since then, he's been the owner and the CEO of Majesty, which is located in Tampa, Florida. So I'm sure we are all very much interested in hearing him speak. So please, let me welcome Vincent Cassidy. Floor is yours.
Perfect, thank you. What a treat to come back 36 years later, to the month actually, and even more of a treat to see a professor that had such a big impact on my academic career, and be able to tell him what an impact he had. And when you refer to the person who taught you only by the last name, Dawes, I thought it was kind of cool back then. And it's just even cooler now to see what a difference he's made in so many lives. So, Professor Dawes, thanks for what you did for me. Part of the reason I've succeeded in my life is believe that this department actually asked if I would speak to you today, and I'm so grateful that you would want to listen to my story. I'm very humbled, actually. And normally when I speak, I go off record all the time. And I hope I don't do that today, because I want to make sure I convey a thought. So bear with me if I strangle or if I strangle. To you, congratulations. Wonderful job getting a degree. You really should be proud. To the parents and family who supported them during this time, congratulations to you. I have two daughters who went through college. I know what it's like to support. And to anybody who had a financial role, either tuition or gave you a job, congratulations for investing in education. Very wise of you. You can see, I can tell you right now, you got some brilliant people out there who are going to change the world. So congratulations to you. I'm going to talk a little bit today about my years here at Stonybrook, which are a little bit different than you might expect from others. And then I want to give you some thoughts on my 36 years of professional and personal life experiences that helped me get where I am today. Maybe you can take something away. And if anything I say doesn't resonate with you, forget that I was even here. And just remember the great speech by John Franco in a month. So my memories were quite fond, actually. I was a commuter, so my job was to get here as fast as I could. I lived in the South Shore, so I would race up Nichols Road. I would get into Dawes class. I would do as best I can. The worst day was when I had a 9 o'clock class and then a 3 o'clock class, because I would have to kill 5 hours in between in the library. But I met some great friends doing it, Steve being one of them. We had some really good times in the library studying and challenging each other. But the two things that I took away from my experience here, I'm curious if you can remember these yourself, is when springtime came and the smell was in the air of the trees and the grass, you knew it was the end of the semester, right? You knew it was coming. And smell is such an important part of our physiology that to this day, despite living in Tampa, by the way, you're welcome to the weather that I brought you these two couple days. To this day, when I smell something fresh, it takes me right back here to this time in my life. And when I went to school here, they used to sell pretzels outside the library. They still do that. You know, hot pretzels, you get a soda, and I can smell, you know, if you walk down New York City, you smell the guys, the chestnuts and the pretzels, that's what it's like for me outside the library. Smell of pretzels, the smell of fresh cut grass and trees reminds me of something. That's a very fine memory. I also have another memory that's not so fun. And I'm a very competitive person. And when I was here, you could take one class, pass-fail. And I chose labor economics to take pass-fail. If you ever have the opportunity to take a pass-fail course, try to show up for more than three classes. try to your best to be sober. And what happened to me was, being a competitive person, I sweated that final grade. Failing was not an option for me. And I remember racing down to get that grade and seeing that it passed. But the reason it's not a fond memory is I'm 58, and for the last 36 years, 12 times a year, I wake up in the middle of the night thinking I'm gonna fail that course. So be careful if you take a pass fail course. The memories are not. Before I get into my 36 years, I wanted to congratulate on something else. In business, they often say accounting is the language of business. But economics, I think, is the brain of business. Because your degree has taught you to think, analyze, predict, forecast, and hopefully to act and then react. No matter what career you choose, you'll have decisions to make based on the information you. Knowing how to think is often an assumed skill, when in fact most people will defer to others to think and to decide. And you will see in time in your career that orderly, analytical thinking doesn't happen as often as you think. So don't misunderstand me that I'm being sarcastic or I'm being negative. When I talk, I think I'll wrap these points up, and you'll understand. I'm going to talk a little bit about competition. But today, you got a degree in economics, and you should be grateful that it taught. same time, we founded a community bank in Florida. We sold that bank last month. It was a nice profit on that. And then I was appointed by our governor to serve on a toll authority, where I currently serve as the chairman of the board of that toll authority. And I'll weave some of that into my story today. And since I'm an analytical person, I'm curious if you are the same as I. When I walk into a room, I count immediately. I count chairs, I count people, I count tiles, I count lines. There's some people, my wife is autistic, so she walks in the room and she sees the beauty. I count. So since I count my fondness for economics, I'm going to give you 10 things that happen in my life, 10 values, 10 experiences that shape my life that I hope might shape a resident of Upstream. Number one. Never stop learning, no matter how old you are, no matter what you do, no matter what the subject. At 46 years old, I pivoted from corporate banking to becoming an entrepreneur. I had to learn about a new industry. Right now, my role as chairman of this authority, I'm learning how to build a 2-mile elevated 45-foot roadway for about $200 million. At the same time, learning how autonomous vehicles connected vehicles are going to reshape our cities, our quality of life, and for that matter, real estate development. And it's all about learning. So I know you're going to learn a lot in your next job, your next relationship, but I'm talking about 20, 30, 40 years from now. Keep investing in learning. It's really cool. The mind needs to be challenged. Number two, the single most important skill I hope you develop. Better if you have it, and if you don't, you better have it. That's to communicate. Do not take it for granted. Poor communication affects output and relationships. And by communication, I'm not talking about Twitter. Social media is just a channel. The right answer in the wrong channel is the wrong answer. Your generation has so many channels to exchange information. The trap is you fail to communicate personally. Learn to listen. In fact, I was reminded by my wife yesterday, I still have to. And while that sounds fun, it's absolutely right. I have to keep learning things. If you're in a conversation and you're the only one talking, you're in a boring conversation and you've learned nothing. When someone engages you in communication, find out if someone wants your opinion, wants to vent, or wants you to fix the problem. In business, we too often try to fix a problem when your role was simply to be a sounding board. Communication will have failed, and you would have failed somebody who when motivating and leading people, it's important to empower them, not make their decisions. Learn to write for business. Be concise. Avoid distractions like humor. Emails do not convey intent. They're just words. A friend of mine likes to say, dance like no one is watching, but write an email like it's going to be read in court word for word. If you can't say it in someone's face, don't put it in. Number three, we baby boomers, we're being trained every day to communicate to millennials and to Generation Z. I strongly recommend you learn how to communicate to baby boomers. We are still doing the hiring out there. Right? There are millennials hiring too. But we like to see people in person. We like to know what your values are. We like to know how you can communicate more than 140 characters. We like people who are focused. We want people who prove themselves and are okay to start from the bottom up and work themselves up. Number four, when I started my company, I created and published 4 values and 2 rules, and I want to share them. Of my 4 values, the first was, our clients come first, they pay our salaries. Number two is, you need to be open to coaching and improving, and you need to coach your colleagues and improve them. Number three, the only thing you control is your attitude. You better come with a good one. And number four, John Franco is you have to have fun. There has to be happiness in your theory. If an employee's not happy in my company, I'm just as happy they go work somewhere else. And I'm really truly happy for them if they go work somewhere else. Because being toxic in my company is not an option. My 2 rules are even simpler. You have to understand we're an escrow company. We hold millions of dollars of people's money. During the year, we hold hundreds of millions. So my rule number one is people trust us with their money. My rule number one is you do not steal from the company. Rule number two is you do not kill anybody in my company. Now, if you're in my business at the end of the month, I make maybe 30 to 40% of my money in the last couple of days of the month. It gets a little heavy. People get a little edgy. Personalities get a little raw. It's almost justifiable to kill people, but it's not permitted. But I tell my people, if you break rule number one and steal, I will break rule number two. But if you peel back what I'm talking about, I'm really telling my employees, look, these are my values and these are my rules. I'm telling you to take risk. We can recover from any adverse situation, provided you haven't stolen. Business is not about avoiding risk, it's about managing risk. Number five, and this talks to a little bit what Renan talked about, relationships are the foundation of business. Technology can be the death to relationships. Now I get that I grew up when the PC was first introduced, and you grew up when technology changes every 3 months. But I see technology as a transaction or a facilitator, such as an experience at ATM or an Amazon. But I also see technology as a price-driven decision. If you want to build a solid business model, it's built around relationships. Businesses succeed for one of three reasons: product, price, or relationships. When you think of a successful business based on a product, Apple, Google come to mind. Google has just changed the word search. We no longer search, we Google, right? Are we gonna change the word research to re-Google? I mean, it's changing the words in our economy. A business based on price is Walmart. It takes enormous capital, enormous amounts of capital if you wanna compete at the level of those companies. On the other hand, if you focus on relationships, you can build a company. My company is the largest independent title agent in the west coast of Florida. We didn't exist 10 years ago, and it's all based on relationships. Relationships are investments. You need to nurture them, you need to feed them, you do not ignore them. Please don't think I'm discounting technology. I'm not. Technology is a game changer. But I'm just encouraging you, do not discount relationships and the importance of them. Number six, I kind of love this, I made this up, I think it's accurate, but if you leave here today and quote it, real news, not fake news, but 95% of people believe there's more security in a W-2 than they do in starting their own business. 95% of people will not make the jump to start their own business. So to an optimist, that means 95% of the people will not be your competition when you start a business. One caveat to that observation is, if you're gonna start a business based on values, relationships, go talk to your significant other. If they say no way, you stay where you are. In my case, in May 2006, after finishing my career at Chase, I went to my bride and said, I think I want to start this business based on my skills from banking. And her answer within about a nanosecond was, I'm 100% behind you. So she was all in. So thank you for being behind me there. Number seven, give her a hand, please. People ask me all the time, what's the difference between being a corporate exec and an entrepreneur? Two things come to mind right away. First is the balance in your operating checkbook. When you own a company, you look at it 5 to 10 times a day. I open in the morning, I look at my balance. During the day, I look at my transactions. At the end of the day, I look at my balance. That money is what funds my investments, it funds my salaries, funds my lifestyle. But when I was a corporate exec, I didn't really worry about the balance of the corporate checking account. You're worried about other things. You're worried about goals that somebody else set for you. Which leads me to the second part about the difference. And that is that, second ties to goals. When you work for a corporation, somebody else sets your goals. So my theory, John Franco, is I call it BOSS. BOSS stands for box of. You can fill in with estimates, okay? But think of this as your responsibilities. This is your responsibilities of your job. And when you work for a corporation, somebody else determines what's in your box. And that very well may be, first of all, it's their agenda, it's their goals. But it could be growth margin, it could be sales margin, it could be expense management, it could be technology investment infrastructure. The point is someone else holds you accountable for your box. But when you own your own company, you decide what goes in your box. You decide what's important to you. maybe the same things. And then people will say, well, the boss for your own company has to be significantly larger because it's your own company. And the amazing fact is it's no different working in both corporate and entrepreneurial life. You have the capacity to do a certain amount. You're going to do it for somebody else, or you're going to do it for yourself. So don't be afraid of the fear is that I'm not sure I can handle managers. 95% of the people will not compete with you. Number eight. My friend Peter Anderson, former professional athlete, retired technology executive, said to me once, about 2003, Vince, if you're lucky, you'll get fired one day. Well, that dream came true on December 15th at 10:15, 2005, when I got fired after 25 years at JPMorgan Chase. I never saw it coming. They called it a corporate reorganization. I call it fired when you walk in and they say, hey, we don't need you in this job anymore, go find another. But firing is good for a lot of reasons. And by the way, it puts me in great company. Peter Anderson, my friend, fired. Steve Jobs, fired. Jamie Dimon, running the largest bank in the world, fired. So I feel like it was a good company. But being fired forces you to reinvent yourself. And it's a great ego adjustment. I can tell you at the time before that, my wife will validate that, I had a pretty good sized ego. But there's another side to being fired, and that it's a failure. And failure is good. Don't let anybody tell you it's not. Because if you never failed, then you really never pushed yourself to a certain level that you could have gotten to. I'm not sure that without failing, there isn't something to be learned. Being fired teaches you how to deal with failure. Trust me on that one. You learn how to do things differently. If you think of failure as a singular, negative, defining moment in your life, then you've really missed an opportunity. Great companies, great leaders see the future, and they reinvent themselves before circumstances make their decision for them. Just look at the history of Kodak and Intel. Two dominant companies, one not here anymore, and the other still inventing. Getting fired means you have to go back to get ahead. The adventurous author and leadership consultant, Allison Levine, gives an amazing analogy about climbing Mount Everest. She's done it twice. The first time, she got within 200 yards of the summit and had to turn back. And then went back about 10 years later and did it. But her analogy is, you cannot climb Mount Everest straight up. It's not an uphill hike. You go up, you go back. You go up, you go back. It's the same thing in a career. You go up, sometimes you go sideways, sometimes you go back. It's a chance to learn again. Remember my first point. Keep learning. Number nine, I'm coming to an end here. So. Number nine, when you get to the end of your career, if someone is asked to describe you in one word, you should hope that they use the word character. When I was a young man, I would visit my grandfather often. We had a great relationship, very close. And he used to say to me when I was 12 years old, think about being 12, and this is what you told me. He said, Vincent, you are born and die with one thing, your name, don't ever lose it. 12 years old, didn't know what that meant, but I did know that hearing it for as many years as I did, it became a foundation in my life. The fastest way to attain material things in life is to lie and cheat. And the fastest way to lose everything in life is to lie and cheat. And my final message today is appropriate because it's about finance. And you're used to exam finals, so please listen closely. You're going to have one more important final exam in your life. And it's at the end of the journey on this earth. And when your time comes for judgment day, you're going to be asked one question. And I'm going to give you the answer to. But the answer is never going to be, well, I did this, or I made that, or I married, and I took care of my kids, I took care of my wife. Inventor, or CEO, or a teacher, or athlete, it's never the answer. And the question's going to be, I gave you so many gifts. What did you do with them? You've got an entire lifetime to prepare for that answer. Don't waste it. Make a difference. Be able to answer the question, I gave back. I cared for others. I put the needs of others before my needs. If you can answer that question, that thank you for allowing me to visit with you today and to share my story. My wish to you is that you have many successes.